to welcome all of our family and friends that are here today to honor the incredible life of Clyde McCauley, servant of the Lord Jesus Christ. Would you join me in prayer, please? Father in heaven, we are humbled and blessed at this time, Father, at this homegoing celebration of your servant, Clyde McCauley. And pray, Father, that all the songs, the tributes, the testimonies, scriptures, that everything that is shared here today would bring glory to you for the great, incredible salvation that you have provided for Clyde, for all of us who have put our faith and trust in you, Lord Jesus. Bless this time. Father, comfort this family. Grant them your peace that transcends understanding. And Father, give them, in the midst of the tears and the sadness, the incredible assurance of eternal life that Clyde enjoys at this very time is something that all of us who placed our faith in you will celebrate and enjoy one day. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God. Born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Praising my Savior all the day long. What a friend we have in my sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus. Sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansion bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus and to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise and to know the say the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar. Oh, the Father waits over the way to prepare us a dwelling place there. Help me out now. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. In the sweet by and by, we shall meet on that beautiful shore. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, with my soul, it is well, it is well with my soul. Precious memories. Oh my gosh, I just remembered them and didn't. Precious memories, unseen angels sent from somewhere to my soul. How they linger ever near me, and the sacred past unfold. Tell them all I said hello, Clyde.
My fears ring.
At this time, to pay tribute to this wonderful life, Billy will come at this time and share thoughts and remembrances.
Well, I want to thank all of you for showing up. Lots of people here I haven't seen in 40 years. Got Uncle Cliff sitting over there and Aunt Gloria. Got a cousin that I hadn't seen in 40 years. It's just good to see all of you. I got a call last night, thanks to Dennis Llewellyn, and he called an old friend of mine, Dee Hendon. And Dee played ball with us, and got a lot of ball players here today. And he said, "Hey, I'm sorry to hear about your dad. He's a great guy." I said, "Well, you didn't know him like I did." I said, there's another story to dad. I said, "Y'all just heard one side, and y'all, there's two sides to every story. Every divorce, there's two sides, right? And I won't tell you the other side. I want some people to laugh today. I want you to enjoy being here because we know where he is. And he liked to laugh. It started, now a lot of you here might not know that I was adopted. And it started when we was just about, I was just short of 2 years old. And I got with my sisters, my older ones. I said, "You know what?" I said, "It's about time for mom to find a husband." I said, "Because food's kind of running short around here." I said, "We better get somebody to take care of us." We wasn't really sure what to expect when she brought this guy home. He was kind of easy on us the first year, but I think he was setting us up. And but that things were going to change here pretty soon. Like, you couldn't slam a door. You couldn't leave a light bulb on. I remember getting in the car, a light left on in the house. I think he was kind of cheap, okay? So the light bulb's on. He goes, "There's just three of us back there. It's just Joan, Jane, and myself. Now I'm two, Joan's three, Jane's four. It's only about a year and a couple of months apart from each one of us." He goes, "Who left that light on?" What do you think he heard? "Not me, not me, not me." Because if you did, you're liable to get a spanking. So we kind of a little bit nervous about all that. And we couldn't really figure out, was he a clean freak, or did he want to win yard of the year every year? Because when it was time to eat, I guess he thought we were all dirty. You know, we had a line up for inspection before we could eat. Now, you think I'm kidding. I'm telling the truth here today, okay? Now, maybe stretching a little. So you had to put your hands out, and then he'd like inspect them. No, you don't pass. You got to go back and wash yours again. Well, Joan had to go back three times one time because she was trying to wash one of these little moles off up on her wrist. And that's the way it was. That's the other side of him. Then as far as the yard of the year goes, we had to do those flower beds when we were 5 years old out there. And he would go out there with a rake. He would turn the dirt over looking for a weed. This ain't done good enough. Get them weeds out. I said, gee. I decided, okay, we need a break here. So I went and negotiated us some money. And I said, look, if he's going to work us like a dog, sis, I said, let's go at least get a quarter a week out of this. So we got him. We got a quarter a week out of him. What was the lesson he was trying to teach us? A job worth doing? Job worth doing right. Well, things were going pretty good for us three kids. And then we heard Mom was expecting another baby. Well, we were pretty excited at first because we figured a fourth member of the family could help do some of the work around there. But we found out later Randy was kind of puny. Okay, and Mom didn't want him working too hard. So we didn't get, my wife made a good point. Said, you know, he maybe could have heard inside the womb and how what it was really like for the rest of you. So he just decided to be puny. Well, he was spoiled. And I'll just give you an example of how he was spoiled. Now, this didn't happen for the first three, okay, just for Randy. He had just gotten married, and he was flush with cash. No, he was broke, like all of us when we first get married. And he needed a root canal. So he goes to Mom. He didn't go to his dad, he went to Mom. So Mom said, I need a root canal and I ain't got no money. Now, Randy, we'll take care of you because I think this is a pre-existing condition. Yeah, well, one day, Joan and Jane thought they were surprised. Mom and Dad. We lived in Penn Haven. Now, Bill Adams lived across the street from him. I've known Bill longer than he's known himself because I was there 1 year when he was born. And we've known each other our absolute whole lives. So one day I'm over there visiting with Bill. And Mom and I mean, you think about how different it is today versus what it was back then. He left us there by ourselves. Okay, how old were y'all when y'all did them floors? 5 years old. So that meant I was maybe three, four, and five, whatever. They were going to do the floors. They were old tile floors to really surprise Mom and Dad what a great job they would do while they were gone. Now, we lived in Penn Haven, about 800 square feet, and there was a few of us in that house. And they knew that ammonia would clean the floors. And if ammonia would do it diluted, by golly, straight ammonia would really do a good job. And the floors, when they got back, looked like they were tie-dyed. They ruined them. I go, oh, you don't think they were scared? Remember, this is the guy that won the win yard of the year. And he surprised us. He actually showed a little grace, a little patience, and a little forgiveness. They were relieved. But he was still strict on the food. See, he was kind of cheap. And he watched every quarter, didn't he, guys? And if you put it on your plate, you had to eat it. Well, Jane, you know, I don't know how y'all eat, but we used to put ketchup on our lima beans. Jane put too much ketchup on the lima beans. So she had to add some more lima beans so it didn't taste so gross. But now she had more food than she could eat. And she couldn't get up until she ate the food, and she was getting sick. How'd that turn out? Did you eat them? She ate them all, because we knew what the result would be. What was he trying to teach us? Don't make promises you can't keep, right, Jane? Put it on your plate, eat it. Well, by now, we're getting on up in age now. We're like 8, 9, and 10. Randy's 4. Then we found out another one's coming. Well, If the third one was puny, or the fourth one was puny, what do you think we nicknamed the fifth one, Suzanne? She was Queenie. And what is it that queens don't do? They don't work, they don't get dirty, but they give orders. Hey, I need y'all to do this. Hey, I need you to do that. And they don't get spanked either. But she did. I asked her last night, I said, were you ever spanked? Because I got them all the time. She goes, yeah, I had two of them. Two. I said, I've got those. I've had two in a day before. What in the world did you do wrong that Dad would spank the Queenie? She goes, they went on one of these, you know, our vacation was a World Series trip. If he was coaching the team, went to the World Series, we got a week at the Holiday Inn, and that was our vacation. Not like today where they take you to Aruba and Spain, wherever all these people go for vacation. So she went out with a guy named Pumpkin Riddles. And maybe some of you heard of him, some hadn't, but he's just one of the old ball players. And where were y'all in Barton? Down South Florida. And they went and swiped all the oranges off the orange trees. That's back when we had orange trees down there. Took all the oranges off the trees and loaded up all the chests of drawers and all the motel rooms. And so she got her little rear end tore out for that, but that was the only one she ever had. Now, Pumpkin, how many of y'all remember that we used to call Dad Slick? All right, well, there's a story behind that. How did he get the name Slick? Well, he coached a lot, obviously. He started when he was real young. And we were losing the game by one run. And it was the last inning with two outs, and the guy struck out. Game would have been over. But the catcher dropped the ball. And so the runner got the first save. He stole second, and make a short story long, he ended up scoring, tied the game up, and he ended up winning the game. And that little 5-6-year-old kid, what he was, he goes, that was Slick. He goes, I think I'm going to call you Slick from now on. And so that's how he got the name Slick. So, heck, all the kids started calling him Slick. So we thank you, Pumpkin. But remember, he's the same guy that did the oranges, too, so he wasn't in trouble. So, well, he finally started easing up on us a little bit. I think he's a, if you think about it, now when he got married, he had an instant family. And Dad was only 23 years older than me, or 25, let's see. He's 23 years older than me, so he was 25, I think, when he married Mom. Now he had an instant family, and he had to get a house for us, so he bought one in Penn Haven. And he told me, he said, man, I don't know how, and I didn't know how in the world I was going to pay for that thing. That mortgage payment was $53 a month. So what he did is he took the food off the table to make up the difference. Now, y'all know he worked for the civil service. And so he got a paycheck every other week. And every other week, we went out. We went to McDonald's. That's what eating out was back then. All three of us still remember this. You could have a hamburger and a fry and a Coke. If you wanted a milkshake and hamburger, you didn't get a Coke because there was 50 cent limit there. Well, after I'm getting to be a teenager, I'm trying to grow, but it's hard to grow without nourishment. And I went to him, I said, Dad, I said, I think I'm old enough now, I need two hamburgers. McDonald's just isn't that big. So I got the drink, the fry, and two hamburgers out of this guy. So he's definitely easing up. So we're getting a little older now, we're moving along. He's teaching us a lot of lessons, but what was he really teaching about the money? Something that nobody had really, these younger kids learned today. He's managing the money, isn't he? He's not spending more than he has, he's saving, and that's gonna come in handy a little later in the story. So good friend of mine, Wayne Sumlin, we called him Rufus, because that was his name, Rufus Wayne Sumlin. We got the 56 Chevy one night. We take it out. We're coming down Leon Highway, and we run out of gas. Now, Wayne, he thought he was a mechanic, okay, because he was a year older than me. He was smarter than me. And so he said, you know, we need to pour a little gas in the carburetor. Let's get that thing to crank up. So we did. And when we went to crank it up, you know what happened? It caught on fire. And now that engine's on fire. So We were fortunate. It was a little like an automotive shop there, so I ran around the back of the building. Lo and behold, they had one of those gardening buckets that you pour out with water. Water right there. We filled that thing up. I run around to the front of it. It looked like somebody had shot that can with a shotgun. It had holes everywhere. When I got there, there was no water left in the can. Some guy comes by Leon Highway, it's about midnight, had the window down. He goes, "Throw sand on it." So we started throwing sand all over the engine, and we got the fire put out. So we walked home. It wasn't that far. I said, "Roof," I said, "you got to go in there and tell Daddy what happened." He goes, "Me?" He goes, "It's your daddy." I said, "But I'm afraid of him, and he likes you." I said, "You go in there and tell him." So midnight, woke him up, went in there, told him, said, "CR, we caught the car on fire." He just laid there, "Okay, how'd you get it out?" So we threw sand on it. "Did you put the breather back on the carburetor before you did?" And we looked at each other, we didn't know. And for you women out there, the engine's okay if the breather's on. If not, we got sand all in the engine, it's toast. He never even got out of bed. He didn't go look at it. He didn't say a word. He said, "Well, we'll check on it tomorrow, boys." Make a long story short, the engine was okay. So you can see how this guy's changing. Now he's starting to become that personality that the rest of you know and like, right? And we're starting to like him a little bit ourselves. He's getting a little easier on us. Until we took up boxing. "Hey, how am I doing on time? I know I only got 20 minutes, and we're going to stay on schedule. Anybody check my time? Okay, well, I'll keep going then." Did y'all see all the pictures in the back where he had the boxing gloves on? He was actually a gold gloves champion in the state of Mississippi when he was an amateur, and he could fight. Well, I thought I was pretty bad. And it's a time to get a little revenge on the dad that wouldn't feed me, made me work like a dog, right? So let's get the boxing gloves on, Dad. So we did. I'll tell him, "Don't you teach me how to box." We got them on. "This is going to be easy." Bam! He hit me with that left, hit me right in the chin. This was a 3-second fight, by the way. And you've heard of a glass jaw, but I never knew what one was. When you have a glass jaw and it hits you in the chin here, it does something up here in your temples, and you go and it blacks out. It is nighttime, and you are as awake as I am right now. And I can't see anything. Now I'm at his mercy. I put a, "Don't hit me, Dad, don't hit me." I said, "I can't see anything." So he didn't hit me. So a friend of mine, Bobby Couture, he was about 4 years older than me, but he wasn't quite as tall as me. He was just laughing. I said, "And then you put the gloves on and you fight him." So Bobby puts them, we're in the garage, so he puts the gloves on. Dad worked him over there by the garage door and he hit him with the left. You just have to visualize this, it's funny. And when he hit him, his head went back and hit the garage door and then it bounced forward. And he hit him again, back forward, four times. I was in stitches, Bobby was on the ground. "Don't hit me no more, Slick." Pulverized him. You know, one thing Dad didn't, did y'all know that Dad once played the national champion from China in ping pong? He got beat, but he was good enough to play him. They had a match set up down at the YMCA downtown, and he actually got to play him. And we got pretty good at ping pong, Rufus and I, and Dad and my brother. But, you know, we never could beat him. We couldn't beat him at checkers, couldn't beat him at ping pong, really couldn't beat him at anything. But he found out he liked baseball. So I thought, you know, we got to get his mind off this work and get him interested in sports. And so we had some catcher's gear, and I thought, well, I want to see what it's like to have all this. You know, I'm only like 8 years old. What's it like to have a mask on, these shin guards and all that stuff? So we're in the backyard, Penn Haven. I said, "Here, you be the pitcher." So if I was about 8, what's that put him at? 31, 32 years old. And he's going to pitch. Now, how would you pitch with your son today if you were 31 and he's 8? You wouldn't be winding up, throwing as hard as you can, which he did. And I caught the ball and it knocked me backwards. And he did two more that way. And I'm not playing with you. You're crazy. So we got him interested in baseball and he started coaching and he became successful. And he was doing okay until Greg Payne and Eddie and myself all got picked up when we were 13-year-olds on being his team. And we made him the legend that he is today. Because he was just so, he had a good reputation, but we won 33 straight games down there at Myrtle Grove. Nobody's ever done that before. I think he's got every record there is down there for games coached. won everything. But how did he do that? He stuck with the same age group every year, coaching a different bunch of boys. And we ran thousands of kids through there, and he coached them all, and that's why they all loved him. What do they do today? Well, I'll coach my son, and when he's 2 years too old, they quit. They don't coach anymore, and we get a new coach. He just stayed down there for 20 or 30 years coaching because he loved those kids. And when we won those 33 games in a row, that's when he became a legend. After Greg, Eddie, and myself left, you know, he never endured that success, never saw it again like he had when we was with him. So we made him that legend. Great dad, sense of humor, went from not knowing what he was doing to what he was doing. When I got to be, I was 26 years old, I opened up a tune-up shop on 9th Avenue. I didn't have any money. And I told her, Teri, I said, you know what, if I had a little money, I said, I think I could open these up and be successful. I had a little book I found in the trash can over at mother-in-law's house. It was open up a 10-minute oil change shop. Had to pay $15 for that book. So I've got that thing, and that's how I learned to get in business. I said, Dad, I said, if you can loan me $20,000, I can open one of these up. Now, that new house we moved in on Carpenter Street, he paid $20,000 for it. This is the guy that only one time gave me any money ever. Walking out the door on a date, and I didn't have any money, so it wasn't going to be much of a date. And I was just kidding. I said, hey, old Pops, you think you could give me $5? He said, sure. And whipped out the $5, and I didn't think I was going to make the date because I was on the floor, passed out. He gave me $20,000 to open that shop up. Well, how in the world did he get $20,000? Because he had all these kids to raise, and he, you know, civil service job, it's a nice job, but you don't get rich, and he saved his money. And he cut the food back, right? That's where the money came from. So he was able to help his kid. He was able to help us out because he saved his money. He managed his money. He didn't believe in participation trophies, did he? No, and he wouldn't brag on us. I remember one time I went 3 for 4, had a home run, a triple, and a double. Not bad. Probably the best game I ever had. He didn't ever tell me I did a good job or nothing. I said, Dad, I said, what do you think about tonight? Had pretty good. He goes, what'd you do the fourth time at bat? Okay. He didn't believe in bragging on us. Okay for somebody else to brag on you, but he is not going to brag on his kids. And I think that's a good example. Now you look at what the world's like today, totally different than the way we were raised. He did a great job. We love him. Couldn't ask for a better dad, could we? Nope. That's all I got to say. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it.
Thank you, Billy. It has certainly been my privilege over the past 22 years to serve as Clyde's pastor, under-shepherd here at Myrtle Grove Baptist Church. To say that this man, in light of what you just heard by way of testimony of his impact on his family, to say that Clyde lived a full life would be an understatement. Incredible life would be more like it. Going home to be with the Lord after 90 years here this side of heaven. On Saturday, November 16th, he closed his eyes here and opened them up in the presence of Jesus. Survived in this life, in this world, by his wife of 64 years, Jane, who's sitting right here on the front. He loved her with great passion. They shared a full life together, 64 years, on their journey this side of heaven. Along with his daughters, Jane Bonelli, husband John, who I've also had the privilege of serving as their pastor, Joan Miller, husband Joe, and Suzanne Vickrey and husband Kevin, along with his sons, of course you just heard from Billy, his wife Teri, and Randy and his wife Stephanie. Also survived by 12 grandchildren, 27 great-grands, and 4 great-great-grandchildren. Wow. You don't see family. In fact, the director of the funeral home here said, you don't see families this large anymore. And I would add to that by saying, you don't not only don't see families this large, you don't see families this close. Truly a patriarch for the entire family, all of you here, and of course many beyond that would be grafted in spiritually to his family. You know, I was thinking of scriptures that would really speak loudly to his life. You know, after spending some time talking to Jane, a little bit more insight that I was given here about the testimony, of course, that you just heard from Billy. I thought of Galatians chapter 5 and verses here that speak to the fruits of the Holy Spirit. In fact, would you stand, ladies and gentlemen, in honor of God's word, listen very carefully to these inspired words. The Apostle Paul says to the church of Galatia, I say then, walk by the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. For the flesh desires what is against the Spirit, and the Spirit desires what is against the flesh. These are opposed to each other, so that you don't do what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. For the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faith, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Since we live by the Spirit, we must also follow the Spirit. You may be seated. Just a couple of observations I want to make here. First of all, you know, the Bible is God's revelation to us. In the Bible, he invites us initially into a personal relationship with him, which produces salvation. But then from that point forward, daily we're invited to walk with him, to walk by the Spirit, to abide in him. It's a choice. It's a decision that every human being has to make. And of course, if we're talking about the sanctification, the walking with the Spirit, the daily decision, it's one that all of us have to decide every day whether we're going to abide, we're going to follow, we're going to walk with, heed, listen to the voice of the Holy Spirit, or go our own way, even as believers. Clyde must have made this decision at a young age, early in his life. And we know that by the evidence that we see of that walking in the Spirit or abiding in Christ. And that's the fruit of the Spirit that was exemplified in his life. You know, it was given testimony here just a few minutes ago about what he was as a dad. You know, two things that were out of the fruits of the Holy Spirit that I think would characterize Clyde that I saw personally, and I'm sure all of you would agree, is the fruit of love, patience, and self-control. You know, a lot of people are up and down in their life emotionally, you know, kind of goes with the waves of the ocean, like and blown around with the winds, you know, of various kinds that hit our life every day. But this man, Clyde, was consistent. I've never seen him not consistent in terms of his temperament, his attitude, his treatment of others. This guy had a consistent life, consistently manifesting the fruit of patience and self-control, of love and gentleness. It was evident. I've given testimony of his own children, not only in his home, but outside the home. In addition to that, Clyde was also a doer of the word. One of the things that many of you know, his family and many friends, not everybody, one of the things that was true about Clyde, that he was a doer of the word. He just didn't talk a good talk. He walked the walk. It was seen in the way he cared for widows here in this community. A friend of his would die, he would ensure and make sure that somehow that widow was cared for, they were helped. We had other members that he knew closely, good friends like Jimmy Britton, that did many of the same things. But it was consistent with Clyde that he would care for the widows. You know, the Bible says in James chapter 1, this really speaks to, again, to Clyde's life, like in Galatians in chapter 5. It says in verse 22, be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. Because if anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like a man looking at his own face in a mirror. For he looks at himself, goes away, and immediately forgets what kind of man he was. But the one who looks intently into the perfect law of freedom and preserves in it is not forgetting, not a forgetful hearer, but one who does good works. This person will be blessed by what he does. For if anyone thinks he's a religious without controlling his tongue, then his religion is useless, and he deceives himself. Pure and undefiled religion before our God and Father is this. Here it is, folks. To look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself unstained by the world. You know, being a doer of the word. His life impacted a lot of people. Not only by what he said, by what he did. He also was a guy that invested his life in others, along with members of this church family and his own personal family. He, along with Amos Whetstone, another great member, now in heaven, I'm sure they're having a great reunion, Jimmy Britton, who went home to be with the Lord a few months ago, these three guys invested in the lives of hundreds of young people in coaching baseball. I was talking to Dennis Llewellyn, who played professional ball and grew up here. Though Dennis always, he was not coached by Clyde, but played on the opposite teams that played against Clyde's team. But Dennis said, you could see in the character of this man, you always admired the way he invested his life in young people. Dennis was telling me, and I wasn't aware of this, that on Facebook, I don't know how many of you have looked on there recently, there were tributes coming in, Dennis told me, from people that Clyde coached, who are men, grown men now, like Dennis, who attest to the fact of this man's impact on their life. He just didn't coach baseball. He coached life lessons by the very disposition we just talked about, that he manifested in his character, the very character of Christ. You know, the Bible says in Romans chapter 8, verse 29, that we were all of us who are Christians, were to be conformed to the image and likeness of Jesus. In other words, to bear the very character of Christ. That is the fruit of the Holy Spirit. Jesus said in John 15, I'm the vine, you're the branches, he told his followers, abide in me. That means walk in the Spirit. Another way of talking about walking, being guided by the Spirit. Abide in me and you will bear fruit. And the fruit of the Spirit, we just listed them all. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, humility, self-control. He not only did that for his family, not only inside of his home, but with hundreds of young men that were under his coaching that not only learned about baseball, but learned life lessons, how to play fair, how to play right. And then they were able to catch a lot of the things that exuberated from Clyde. That love, that joy, that peace, that patience. He didn't scream at the kids, you know. He was strong, but he was a strong, yet gentle spirit. Truly a man's man. You know, we talk about being a man's man, showing and manifesting true masculinity. Well, the character of Jesus, that was the strongest man I've ever known and that you've ever known, if you're a believer. Clyde manifested the character of Christ and taught those young men. There are a lot of things, you know, we go through life, we get older. There's a lot of things we forget. People that we forget just erase from our mind. Then there's some people in our life that make such an impact on our life, we don't forget them. And that was Clyde McCauley. Right, Dennis? And a score of people. Many of them went on to play professional ball. Some of them left after school, didn't play anymore, but they remembered the man. They remembered the man. They remembered the impact. One last thing. You know, we believe as Christians, though it's hard to wrap our finite mind around the infinite, around eternal life. But I am reminded every time I think of a passage in the closing of the Bible in Revelation chapter 1, it gives us a glimpse of what heaven is going to be like for all of us in that grand reunion. For those who placed our faith and trust in him, one day, the Bible says, according to John the disciple, inspired by the Holy Spirit, right in there being cast away by Rome and the Roman government, away from family and friends, on the island of Patmos, given this vision, this revelation of God, he wrote these words about the heaven that is yet to come, the new heaven, the new earth. He said, "Then I saw a heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea no longer existed. I also saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared like a bride adorned for her husband." What imagery, huh? Trying to capture something that would talk about beauty, and he thought about a bride adorned on her wedding day. I can testify to that. That was one of the prettiest sights I ever saw. It was my sweet Marilyn coming down the aisle to join and exchange vows with me. And 42 years later, I heard with a loud voice from the throne, "Look, God's dwelling is with humanity. He will live with them. They will be his people. God himself will be with them and be their God." And listen to this, friend. "He will wipe away every tear from their eye. Death no longer exists. Grief, crying, pain will exist no longer. Because the previous things, the old things have passed away." Then the one seated on the throne said, "Look, I am making everything new." Do I hear an amen on that one, friend? Everything new. And the heaven right now, the intermediate heaven that he instantly was raptured up to, where he's at right now in the presence of Christ, all these things exist now in the present, and that new heaven and earth one day, and we'll all enjoy each other's favor. I can say deep in my heart, without a shadow of a doubt, you will see your father, your grandfather, great-grandfather, father-in-law, husband again. And this sweet lady right here, with a clear thought, a clear mind, they will know each other in glory and be perfect. And every trace of disease that we experience here in this world will be gone. That's not wishful thinking, friend. That's a fact of the Word of God. Amen, folks. That's a fact. I'm wondering here, outside of the immediate family, how many of you sitting out here right now have been touched in some way, impacted by Clyde's life? Would you stand, please? Family, look around, if you would. And you know what? There's probably 100+ more in a personal way that aren't here right now that would be standing. And that's a tribute, by the way, and a blessing to all of you, this immediate family right here. My, my, how proud you can be. What a legacy. Oh, my goodness. What a legacy you have. And I know the impact of each one of you wanting to desire to pass this on to your children. You know, I always think about that. And Homegoings, you know, it'll be my family standing up here one day talking about me. And what kind of legacy do we want to leave? Think about that for a moment. Just in case, and I would be remiss if I didn't say this right now. And I think Clyde would be angry with me if I didn't say it. I don't know everybody here. But I know he would want me to say that if you have never, if you, for whatever reason, dismissed Jesus Christ as a reality, I would beg you right here now, for the sake, for his sake, for your sake, for heaven's sake, reconsider Jesus Christ and reconsider what a relationship with the Lord could do for you. You may be scratching, crawling, disappointed, angry, bitter about something that happened in the past. Did you know that the cross of Christ can wipe that away? Through forgiveness and grace, dear friend, you could start, I don't care how old you are, by the way, you can start a brand new chapter of your life right now, today, by making a decision that Clyde made years ago and putting your faith in something that can't be scientifically proved, but something, friend, if you want to hear testimonies, there are millions of them. And there's several dozens upon dozens right here in this room right now that would give their life without any hesitation for the faith. Well, may God bless, and I say to all of you here, May the Lord bless you with the peace of God that transcends all human understanding. As Paul said, may that peace guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. Roy's going to come now and sing.
How great a chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness, you tore through shadows of my mold. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to breathe. Out of the silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. God, you are my living hope.
This time we have some of the grandchildren are going to be coming to share scripture. If you would come at this time, please.
First Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 4 says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you." Okay, all the great-grandchildren come up. All right, John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17. Go.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life.
For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Wasn't that beautiful? Clyde loved children. George Butler, his brother-in-law, the two of them would get up early often and go to the Family Life Center over here, and they would walk, just kind of walk inside, for exercise. But one of the things that they really enjoyed was when the children would come out from our preschool learning center, they'd love to embrace and encourage and speak to the children. He loved that. You could tell by this enormous family that's here and all these grandchildren that are up on the platform how his love for children was so pure, so real. He made, Jane told me that when you'd go to his house, he made that house a home because of the way he gave special attention to all of his children, even as they grew up and the grandchildren. Jane had mentioned every time they came, they'd always leave with a gift. Some little token, something he'd give them going out the door. At this time, we're going to have a scripture reading from the great-grandchildren, I believe, will come at this time. Oh, they just did. They all came up. Okay, all right. I wasn't sure. There's so many, I wasn't sure if we had more to go. We're going to have a song, and you have remained seated at first, if you would please. And the song is, "I Will Rise." Listen carefully to the words before we close in prayer.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome. and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome and the grave is
Lord Jesus, Father, we long and look forward to the day of the resurrection. Father, thank you for the incredible, blessed assurance that's ours because of your Son, our Lord, his resurrection, his conquering death. For death has no more sting to it. For those of us who have met you, know you, love you, Lord, you take the sting out of death with the glorious realization that one day all of us that have put our faith in you will be together one day in a great reunion. Till that time, we pray, praise your name for your servant Clyde, his life, his legacy. In Jesus' name, amen. All God's people said, everybody, amen. Remain standing, if you would, please. Our attendants will come right now to give us a direction for the graveside service.
Thank you, Pastor. That does conclude the service here in the sanctuary. We will be going to Bayview Cemetery for the burial. For those of you going with us in procession, there's a couple things we need to do. We must turn our headlights and flashers on. And then if you must get out of the procession, pull over to the right-hand side, remain there until everyone has passed, and then you could be on your way. This is for your safety, as well as those officers we'll be escorting today. We're going to need to leave within the next 5 minutes, or we're going to lose our escorts. So we're going to move quickly. At this time, I want our pallbearers, if you'll meet us in the foyer. Thank you very much. Pastor, I'm going to let you lead the way on this side. We're going to go out this side.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul, I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will disappear.